who are perishing. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. You see, we don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we ourselves are your servants for Jesus' sake. For God who said, "Let there be light," and we ourselves are your "Let there be light in the darkness," has made this light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. We now have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. Through suffering, our bodies continue to share in the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be seen in our bodies. Yes, we live under constant danger of death because we serve Jesus, so that the life of Jesus will be evident in our dying bodies. So we live in the face of death, but this has resulted in eternal life for you. But we continue to preach because we have the same kind of faith the psalmist had when he said, "I believed in God, so I spoke." We know that God, who raised the Lord Jesus, will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. All of this is for your benefit, and as God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving, and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long, yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. I'm sure God would add a blessing to the reading of his word. Pick for the theme this morning and from this passage, getting life into focus. When we think of focus, we think of a central point that we look upon, that we meditate on, that we focus on. It's a central point that attracts us in such a way that it draws our attention, and we have to be focused on the central point. Eight times in this chapter we read the word see or seen, which is definitely dealing with focus. We have something in this word of God today that we need to focus upon. And you may ask us, well, why do we need to get our life into focus? I think we all, in the past 10 months and in the years gone by, can really take in a greater understanding of verses 8 through 12. It says that we're pressed on every side by troubles. We're puzzled or we're perplexed. We're hunted down. We get knocked down. And through suffering in our bodies, we all, in some way, in some sort of, experience this in our lives. So that's why it's so important today and the rest of our life that we get our life into focus. That when these things come upon us, that we'll be able to deal with the areas of life that so often knock us down. But the great thing is that when we get our life into focus, although we're pressed on every side, the Word of God reminds us we're not crushed. We're perplexed, but we're not driven to despair. We're on to down, but we're never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we're not destroyed. Think of that this morning, even that word, us getting our lives into focus. So how do we get life into focus? I want to look at three steps this morning, briefly from this chapter. And it's going to sound contrary at the beginning, but for us to get our life into focus, we got to take the focus off of us. We have to focus on Christ. Paul then, verse 5, said, you see, I don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we ourselves are your servants for Jesus' sake. Paul's focus was preaching Christ, not preaching himself. Paul would tell us then, Philippians 1 and 21, for him to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What the Apostle Paul is saying to us throughout Scripture is that his purpose of life was to focus on Christ, not himself. He wanted his life to be lived in such a way that Christ was that central point. Christ was that attraction that when he stood and ministered wherever he was, that people didn't see him, they seen Christ. And Paul wanted to exalt Christ because he knew that it was only Christ that was going to get him through life, and that would get us and the people he preached to through life. That when troubles came, when they were puzzled in life, when they was hunted down, they would never be abandoned by God. They would never be destroyed. Another great illustration of focusing on Christ we find from Matthew 14, and we all know the story well, when Peter walked on water. The disciples was out in the Sea of Galilee there, and that storm came upon the sea. And it said that Christ came on the walking on the water in the form of, the disciples thought it was a ghost. And when Christ spoke, Peter said, Christ, if that's you, bid me to come out of the boat. Let me walk on the water. And of course, Jesus granted his desire. He said, come, Peter. And as Peter was focusing on Christ, Peter was walking on the top of that storm. He was walking on the waters. But verse 30 reminds us that when he took his eyes off of Christ and he started focusing on that storm that he was in, what happened? He began to sink. And that so often is how our lives are. We get into storms of various kinds, and we start out focusing on Christ, and everything is well. But then we start getting caught up in what I have to do. How am I going to do this? How am I going to get through this? And all of a sudden, we find ourselves sinking in that sea of trouble. But Peter, when he realized that he was sinking and not on the top of the storm anymore, he cried out, Lord, save me. And it says, immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand. You know, I was talking with a great friend, and over the last few weeks, we've seemed to really ponder on everything that's going around. And oftentimes, we try to plan out our day or our days or week, and it's like, all of a sudden, everything that we're planning isn't taking place. Something goes wrong. But when we look back on it, everything that we planned to do got done. Not the way we planned it, but the way God planned it. And I think that is something that we need to recall to mind often and acknowledge that when we look back on the storms of life, and when we look back at what God has done for us, we acknowledge that it's God that has done it. And we don't focus on ourselves, but rather we focus on Christ. Step one, we take the focus off of ourselves and we focus on Christ. Step two, we focus on the power that is from God. Verse 7 says, now we have this light shining in our hearts. But we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. You know, Paul's focus at heaven was not on this perishable human body or this perishable container, but rather Paul focused on the priceless content that was inside of this container. And we think of that today as the Holy Spirit that indwells us, the one who helps us through life, the one who leads us through everyday life. And often, you know, we pray, and I pray for the Holy Spirit to guide me in my life each day. But then I started to think about that. That is his call. That is part of his work of guidance in the Christian life. He's going to guide you every day. Maybe we need to start praying that we are obedient to his call, that we're focusing on his call in our life, and we become obedient to that call, to that focus. But Paul says, though we are living in these fragile clay jars, you know what? God is still using us to share the good news of the gospel. Not only is he using us to share the good news of the gospel, but if God calls us to do something, God empowers us to do it as well. We focus on the power that is from God, not on our own. And as we realize that and we know that the power is his, and not ours, it will keep us from pride that so often wants to set in. And most of all, it motivates us to focus on God on a daily basis in our lives, realizing that God is the power source of a Christian's life. And our responsibility, as it was with Paul's, is to let our community, our families, the world around us, our workplace, see that God is working through us. Our third step is this, our focus is eternal. In verses 14 through 18, we see this, that we know that God who raised the Lord Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. And this is for your benefit, as God's grace reaches more and more people, that there will be great thanksgiving and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies, these fragile clay jars, are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. Think of that. Our spirits are being renewed every day. Though someone may get saved at the age of 15 and they live to be 90, think of the day of their 90th birthday, their spirits are renewed more and more than it was when they accepted Christ at that early age of life. What a blessing we have. Yet they produce for us a glory. Our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them all and will last forever. So we don't look, there again, we don't focus on the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone. And we've experienced that in the last few months. But the things we cannot see will last forever. You know, we've all faced problems in many ways, whether it's in our relationships, whether it's in our workplace, whether it's in our churches, or wherever. And sometimes it pushes us to the point where, you know what, we feel like we say, throwing the towel in. We feel like just giving up. But Paul reminds us that don't quit. Rather than quitting when persecution wore him down, you know what Paul did, and we need to follow his advice, is that Paul started focusing on that power that was within, on that inner strength that came from God through the Holy Spirit. You know, so often it's easy, but I encourage you this morning that when fatigue and pain and criticism comes to you, don't let it force you off of the job, as we would say. Don't let it force you to give up on your Christian walk, but rather take that time, as Tiffany sang, maybe come back to that altar. Renew your commitment to God, to serving Christ. You know, there's nothing this world can offer you that is worth you forsaking your eternal rewards for. You know, because of the intensity of the day that we live in, with so much troubles and so much disease and pain around us, maybe there are all fields that God is working through to show us that those very things of this world that brings us weakness, they're the things that He is using to allow us to see that the resurrection power of Christ can be there to strengthen you moment by moment. Yes, it's easy to focus on trouble and pain, but this morning, I encourage us to focus on our ultimate goal. And that goal is the reward of our faith, the joy that lasts forever. Let us focus on that this morning, the reward that awaits us, the joy that lasts forever. You know, no matter what happens in this life, we have the assurance, as a child of God, of eternal life, when all suffering will end. And then writer says, all suffering will flee away. I'll never forget hearing Daddy talk about some things that was going on in the family's circle, and he asked his daddy, many of you know him, Pastor Stanley, how can these things be? How can we get through this? It seems like maybe God is silent. He's not listening. And I'll never forget the words that Pastor Stanley said to Daddy, that when we don't understand, we trust all the more. And this morning, that's what I want us to do. That when we don't understand why these things are happening and what is going on, we trust Him. We focus on Christ, the one who has given us eternal life. Think of that this morning, church, that nothing can take that away from us. Our eternal life is secured in the resurrection of Christ. That's why Paul ended this chapter with that we don't look at the troubles we see now. Rather, we focus, we fix our gaze on Him, on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. Amen. May God bless the word this morning. As we focus on Christ, step one, we take the focus off of ourselves. Step two, we focus on the power that is from God. And thirdly, we focus on our eternal promise and blessings. The chorus writer put it this way, what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon His face, the one who saved me by His grace, when He takes me by the hand and He leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. I ask you this morning, are you sure Jesus will take you by your hand and lead you through that promised land? We can have that assurance today as we come to the altar. as we commit our lives into Christ, as we focus Christ on Christ as the central point of our lives, we can have that assurance that one day He's going to take us by our hands and lead us through that promised land. I'm not good at racing choruses. Maybe you could sing that chorus in closing, then I'll pray. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. Christ's name we give thanks.